This is one of the saddest episodes in Jewish history, the destruction of Jerusalem in the temple. When we consider those words of Jesus in Matthew 23, verse 37, where Jesus stands after he's spoken to the crowds in the temple and he's standing there before them and he says, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often have I longed to gather you as children together, as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. For I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" That was Jesus' last words when he pronounced six damning statements upon the faith of Israel, upon Pharisaism and all the things that they held to. And as they were walking away from the temple, as we read in chapter 24, verse 1, we hear these words where Jesus speaks to his disciples and says, you know, they comment on the building and said, "What magnificent buildings, what magnificent structures." And Jesus says, "All of it will be thrown down." Now, the destruction of Jerusalem was preceded by what is called in history the first Jewish-Roman war. It started in 66 AD when Nero was the emperor, and it continued well past the destruction of the temple in AD 70. So for 4 years there was this bloody war between the Romans and the Jews, and in AD 70 Jerusalem fell. The Roman general who fought the Jews in Judea was called Vespasian, and he was one of the generals of Nero. Nero died in 68 AD, and Vespasian went to Rome to claim the throne as emperor. Vespasian had two children, Titus and Domitian, both of them who play a role in the Bible. Domitian is the emperor who caused the persecution that we read about in the book of Revelation. And Titus was the son of Vespasian, who took over the war and the siege of Jerusalem when Vespasian went to Rome to be the emperor. And the sad thing is that these things had been prophesied by Daniel already in 539 BC. In other words, more than 540 years earlier, Daniel had already prophesied two things: the destruction of the temple and the day of the Lord. And he said, during the destruction of the temple, before to know that it is near, the Messiah will come. He will come just before the destruction. And after that, it will happen. And then he also prophesied about the day of the Lord, a day of the Lord's vengeance upon the earth, a day of judgment, a day of reckoning. And that he prophesied about in Daniel chapter 12. But today we will focus on the temple because we spoke about the day of the Lord last time. And so as Jesus is walking away, and the disciples, you know, that's what always so funny about these guys. They were, just as we are, quite silly. You know, Jesus had just delivered a damning speech in the temple, speaking about the religion of Israel. He says to the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the teachers of the law, you know, you go over land and sea to make a single convert. And when you do, you make him twice as much a son of hell as you are. That was Jesus' speech. That was sort of the gist of his speech in the temple. And they walking out, and Jesus weeping over Jerusalem, and they walk out and say, "Oh my, what wonderful buildings are these. They are really beautiful." And you see, they just don't get the gravity of the whole thing. And so as they were on their own, on top of the Mount of Olives, they were looking out over the city, they asked Jesus, "When will this happen?" in verse 3. "When will this happen, this destruction you spoke about? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?" And maybe they thought the two of these two events happened at the same time. But it's clear that Jesus answers two different questions. The first, the destruction of the temple, and the next, the end of the age. And Jesus says, you know, this is the final marker that will tell you that the destruction of Jerusalem is near, that the destruction of the temple is near. And the final marker will be something that is called the abomination that causes desolation. In verse 15, he says, when you see standing in the holy place, in other words, the holy place is in the temple, there where God has to be honored, the holy place, not the most holy, the holy of holies, but in the holy place, the abomination that causes desolation, spoken of through the prophet Daniel, that abomination. 539 BC, Daniel spoke about that. You find that in Daniel chapter 9. He says, that is the abomination that I'm speaking about. Let the reader understand. So, what will be the final marker? It will be this thing called the abomination that causes desolation. Now, I don't want to complicate matters, but Daniel speaks about two of these abominations. One of them that already was revealed in the year 167 BC. And we're not going to focus on that one. This one that Jesus is speaking about is the one that will come after the Messiah had been revealed. Notice that Daniel says the following in his prophecy. He says there will be a decree to rebuild Jerusalem. And then after that, 483 years after the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, the Messiah will come. That is what Daniel prophesied. So the first thing that he says is there will be a decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. Remember, the Jews were in Babylon at that time. Judea was lying in ruins. The city of Jerusalem was destroyed. The temple was broken down. And there will be a time when it all will be rebuilt. In fact, the actual command to rebuild the temple was given in 539 by the Medo-Persian ruler called Cyrus the Great. But the rebuilding of the city would only come many, many years later. And Daniel gives a timeline. And it's not an exact timeline. It is an apocalyptic, symbolic timeline. He says there will be seven sevens and 62 sevens. If you add them all up, it's 483 years. So he says, from the time some king will issue a decree to rebuild Jerusalem, 483 years later, the Messiah will come. Doesn't have to be literally exact 483 years, but that's the ballpark. And so what happens? We read in Nehemiah chapter 2 that in 445 BC, King Artaxerxes gave a decree for the Jews to return to Jerusalem and to rebuild the city, to rebuild the walls. So if you add the 483 years, it takes you roughly into the time span of Jesus' life on earth. And that's where they were. And the disciples, by this time, they are convinced that Jesus is the Messiah through all he said and all he did and all he taught. And that's what Daniel says. He says, after this time, the anointed one will come. The Messiah will come. And he says, you know what will happen to the Messiah? He says in Daniel 9:26, he says, the anointed one will be cut off. You will be cut off. And the people of the ruler at that time will come and destroy the city and the sanctuary. And that is all in Daniel chapter 9, verse 26. And so the destruction of the temple will come after the Messiah had come. The fall of Jerusalem would come at that time. The marker that will show that this is about to go down, that this is about to take place, will be this abomination that causes desolation. That is what is prophesied by Daniel in Daniel 9, verse 27. Now the question is, Jesus is telling the disciples this. The disciples are writing this down. It's written down in Mark's gospel, in Matthew's gospel, in Luke's gospel. All the Christians hear this. They all learn this from Jesus. They know there are these markers. The decree to rebuild the city, the Messiah comes, and after the Messiah comes, he will be cut down, he will be killed, and after that, the city will be destroyed. But the marker that the destruction of the city is going to happen is the abomination that causes desolation. And Jesus says, let the reader understand. Obviously, he's speaking these words to his disciples, but at that time he says, let the reader understand, because he knows that his disciples will write this down. He won't be there. When this is going to happen, he won't be there anymore. He would have ascended into heaven. And so he tells his disciples, they write it down, they think about this. They have 40 years to think about this. They have 40 years to think this thing through. And as I said, 4 years before the destruction of Jerusalem, they start this war with the Romans. And all the signs are coming together. And so the second thing that Jesus tells them, he says, flee to the mountains. When you see this sign, this abomination that causes desolation, flee to the mountains. Luke gives a slightly different way of putting this forward. He says in Luke 21 verse 20, he says, when you see Jerusalem being surrounded by armies, what's going to happen? You're going to go about your own business. You're going to happily go to work. You do whatever you do every day, and you hear about this war. You know that there's a war in Judea. They're fighting against the Romans. And then at some stage, you realize that the war is not going well. And Jerusalem is being surrounded by armies. In other words, there's a small window of escape. Once the city is surrounded totally, it will be too late. And it says, when you see standing in Matthew 24:15, when you see standing in the holy place the abomination that causes desolation, let the reader understand, let those in Judea flee to the mountains. Whatever this thing was, and there's a lot of speculation on what it was. Some say that Titus, this Roman general, planted the Roman standard, you know, that pole with the Roman standard on it, planted that in the temple. We know that they desecrated the temple by taking the offering from the temple for the reparations for the Romans. Whatever it was, the sign was clear. There was something in the temple that didn't belong there. The city was being surrounded by armies, and Jesus says, you must understand. When this happens, he says in verse 17, let no one on the roof of his house go down to take anything out of the house. Let no one in the field to go back to get his cloak. Let those who are in the countryside flee to the mountains. Jesus says, you've got one chance. When these things happen, you maybe have half an hour, maybe an hour, maybe a few hours. If you're in the countryside, don't go back to the city. Flee to the mountains. If you're in the city and you're on the roof of your house, don't go down to fetch your cloak. Don't go down to fetch some snacks for the road. He says, all that you have to do is you have to run. Run with all you've got. And run for the mountains. Now, the problem here was that the Christians knew about this. All the Christians knew this prophecy. Remember, it's now 40 years later. For 40 years, Jesus had left them to the teaching of the apostles and the church. And Jesus had gone to heaven. And so they have thought about this for 40 years. They know this is coming. They know Daniel prophesied it. They know Jesus prophesied it. And they see the war developing in Judea. And it's not looking good. And when the time comes, they know about this. They've read the Gospels. They've read Matthew. They've read Mark. They've read Luke. All of them written before the destruction. You know that. That all three, those Gospels were written before the destruction of Jerusalem. The only one that was written after the destruction of Jerusalem was John. Because he's the only one who doesn't mention it. Because it's done. It's over. But all the other three warn about it. They read it. The churches read it. They know it. And they flee. But the Jews don't know it. They don't believe that Jesus is the Messiah. They don't read the Christian books. So they don't know about this. And Jesus goes on and he says in verse 19, how dreadful will it be in those days for pregnant women and nursing mothers? Pray that your flight will not take place in winter or on the Sabbath. It will be terrible times. There was 4 years of bloodshed. 4 years of bloodshed. And then the siege of Jerusalem lasted for 7 months. For 7 months, Jerusalem was surrounded by armies. The worst thing was, it was not just the Romans outside. Inside the city, there were factions fighting each other. Because there were basically three factions who initially fought against the Romans. The Zealots, or the freedom fighters. The Edomians, those are the descendants of Esau. And the Sicarii. And these three groups eventually started fighting each other. They started fighting and battling each other. Some of them tried to control the temple area. And all the while, the Romans are outside starving the city for 7 months. You know, the historians, our most faithful historian, the Jews don't like him very much, but he was a Jew, was Josephus. And Josephus said that at this time, 1.1 million Jews died. 1.1 million Jews. They crucified everybody that they could lay hands on. Anybody who tried to escape, if anybody ran out of the city, they would capture him. They would crucify him on the horizon so that the people in the city could see this. They crucified up to 500 people a day. And Josephus writes and he says, there were so many crosses on the hillside that there were no more place to plant new crosses. And sometimes they crucified more than 500 people a day. It was said that the Roman general Titus was so horrified by the Jews' unwillingness to give up and to declare peace and to stop fighting, that he cried and he wept to his gods. And he said to his gods, I didn't want this. I didn't want this. It was a terrible, terrible time. We are told that more than 100,000 Jews were taken captive and taken into slavery. People were eating their own children. That's how bad it was. We are told that some people, because they wanted to hoard their wealth, would swallow. I'm sorry if there's children here. Would swallow their gold and their silver. And when they flee the city, the Romans would cut them open to find the gold and the silver that were in their bellies. It was a terrible, terrible time. And Jesus says it was something that it says in verse 21, in those days there will be a great distress, unequaled from the beginning, from the world unto now, and never to be equaled again. If those days had not been cut short, no one would survive. But for the sake of the elect, those days would be shortened. It was a dreadful time, and one wonders, when those Jews were crying out 40 years before, when Jesus was hanging on the cross, and they cried out these words, let his blood be upon us and upon our children. if that has not got something to do with this terrible suffering that they brought about themselves. One of the saddest results of this war, apart from the bloodshed and the pain and the suffering, was the development of what we have today is called rabbinic Judaism, out of Pharisaism. If Pharisaism, the religion of the Pharisees at the time of Jesus, was bad, today it's even worse, because today we have what we got, what we call rabbinic Judaism. And it's not the faith of Israel. It's not the faith of the Old Testament. It's what the rabbis and the sages teach. That is what Jews are following today. So they are in total, total darkness. Another sad development of all of this is up to this time, up to AD 70, the Romans, by and large, saw the Christians as a sect of Judaism. They thought Christians were just a specific brand of Judaism, like we had Essenes and Sadducees and Pharisees and teachers of the law and all kinds of other people. But because the Christians, by and large, escaped this terrible slaughter and this horror, because those who knew the words of Jesus, those who read the Gospels, they fled. And hardly any Christians died in this terrible time. But the Jews died, as I said, in mass. And so up to this time, the Romans thought that the Christians were just part of the Judaism. But after this, there was forever a schism between the Jews and the Christians. Up to that time, a Christian missionary like Paul or Peter or Barnabas, whoever, could go to a synagogue anywhere in the empire. And he would go into the synagogue, he could take the Old Testament, he could read from it, and he could talk from it and speak from it. They were able to do that. But after AD 70, all of that came to an end. The third thing that Jesus warns about at this time, apart from seeing the abomination and fleeing, apart from not hanging around the city or in the countryside, the third thing he says is that there will be false Christs and false signs. He says in verse 23, at that time, if anyone says to you, look, here is a Christ, yes, the Christ, or there he is, do not believe it, for false Christ and false prophets will appear and perform great signs and miracles, even to deceive the elect, if that were possible. See, I have told you ahead of time. You know what, dear friends, in hard times, what happens? Rumors spread. What's the one they call on the internet? Conspiracy theories. They develop in hard times, during the time of COVID, during time of war. People talk to each other and say, oh, you know what happened? The government decided they're going to put us all in a huge camp in the middle of the Karoo or whatever. People come up with all these stories. Rumors spread. Some will say, no, he's out in the desert, verse 26. Others say, no, he's secretly gathering behind closed doors. He's somebody in somebody's house. And the internet at this very moment in time, guess what's happening on the internet at this moment in time? There's all kinds of end-time prophecies, all to do somehow with this war in Israel, the war between the Jews and the people of Gaza, and the war that has now spread to Lebanon and most probably may spread to Iran. And all kinds of end-time prophets are coming out of the woodwork. I didn't read the whole article, I just saw the red heifer is on the ground, whatever that means. The red heifer is on the ground. So this kind of thing, the third temple is being built. And so we can go on and on. And false prophets and false Christs proliferate during hard times, but especially at this time. You know why? Because the Jews knew. They knew. what Daniel had prophesied. They knew that once the city is destroyed and once the temple is demolished, anybody who comes after that who claims to be the Messiah doesn't meet the criteria. Do you see that? According to Daniel, the Messiah had to come before the destruction of Jerusalem. No matter what anybody tells you, no matter what the Jews tell you, the Messiah had to come before the destruction of Jerusalem. That is extremely blatantly clear from the prophecy of Daniel in Daniel chapter 9. So the only person who could validly be the Messiah to come somewhere between the decree to rebuild the city and the destruction of the city. And that is from 445 BC to AD 70. In that time period, the Messiah had to come. And these people knew it. And so they were running around and said, we need a Messiah. Because the Messiah is the deliverer. He's the one who's going to break the power of Rome. He's the one who's going to save the city. Or even if he doesn't save the city, he must be revealed. So many people stood up and said, I'm the Christ. I'm the one. And the people followed them to their destruction. Many of the people of Jerusalem and Judea followed false Christ at this time. They proliferated. But there's another thing that we need to know. This is a dress rehearsal. The destruction of Jerusalem is a dress rehearsal of what is going to go down at the end of the world. It's a cameo, just a little skit from the final drama that will be revealed at the end of time. If we think that this suffering is terrible and the death and the horror is something terrible, my friends, this is just a dress rehearsal for that final day. There's a connection. That's why Jesus speaks about these two things at the same time. That's why in the minds of the disciples there's some connection. It's the last event before the return of the Lord of biblical significance. It's like in the old days when you get on the train and say, all stations, Simonstown. You know? And you look at the stations. I knew them. My granny lived in Fishhook. So I go, yeah, there's Clovelly, there's Sunny Cove, and then, you know, Glen Kenny. You know, next one, Simonstown. This is the last station. The next station is the end of the world. That's what Jesus wants you to get. That's what he wants all of us to get. So that we will be ready, my friends, that when this comes, that we will see this war that Titus waged against the Jews was a miniature of the coming of Christ in judgment. And that we should not be led astray by false Christ, false prophets, end time prophecies. If it's not in the Bible, don't go there. Jesus makes it clear in verse 27. He says, as lightning that comes from the east is visible even in the west, so will it be with the coming of the Son of Man. Wherever there's a carcass, vultures will gather. If you're in the game reserve, how do you know that an animal has died? These vultures up above. And it's clear for all to see. It's clear for all the jackals and the hyenas and all the other predators and scavengers also, because they all go. They say, oh, there's something there, and they run. And that's what Jesus is saying. He says, when the Son of Man returns, there will be no doubt. He won't be in the inner rooms. He won't be out in the desert. When he comes, everybody will know and everybody will see. And then he ends off this teaching and he says, learn the lesson from the fig tree. As soon as the twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Maybe you have a fig tree in your home, in your yard. Maybe you've seen one. You know, when summer's coming, they form little buds and then little leaves. In winter, they bare, there's nothing. And then they start sprouting leaves, and not long then the figs appear. And you know, summer's coming. And Jesus says, even so, if you understand how a fig tree works, when you see these things, the destruction of Jerusalem, the suffering, all this false Christ and false Messiah, you know what is near? Right at the door? The destruction. In their generation, he says to them, to the people listening to him, to his disciples, I tell you, this generation, in other words, the generation of the disciples, they will not pass away until the destruction of Jerusalem would come. It would happen in their lifetime. Some of them would be martyred before then. But certainly John made it through the destruction, because he still wrote his gospel afterwards. But we know that Peter and Paul died, and some others, James and so on. But Jesus says it will happen in this generation. And so, my friends, when we look at the world around us today, yes, there are signs. There are signs. There are signs that things are not good in the world as it is. We can't give a time indication. There's no clear time indication provided in the Bible. But we know that the Messiah had come. According to Daniel, we know that the Messiah had come. Even if Jesus wasn't the Messiah, then he had to come before the destruction. So there's no one else. So the Messiah had come. The temple was destroyed. And the only outstanding item on the agenda of world history, as far as God is concerned, is the coming of the Lord, the return of Jesus. And when he comes, will he find faith on the earth? Will he find faith in your heart and in your mind? Will he find that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, my friend? Those things lie in the past. We can't do anything about it. But make sure today that your name, you've seen the markers, you've seen fulfilled prophecy, is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Have you trusted in Jesus? Have you listened, obeyed to the gospel? Obeyed the gospel. The gospel call is repent and believe. And that's all that we can do, my friends. Have you trusted in Jesus? Have you fled the dying philosophies, ideas, and dying cities of this world to become a member, a citizen of Zion? Amen.